Good afternoon, board members, college staff, administration. Thank you for being here. The time is 6 o'clock on the 8th day of April, and I call this meeting, the Laredo College Board of Trustees, to order. May I have Trustee Delgado say a prayer, please?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Loving and gracious God, you are indeed the giver of all good gifts, and we thank you today for all your blessings, for the successful outcomes of our college events, and for all of our faculty, our staff, and most importantly, our students. We ask that you bless them abundantly, and we continue to seek your wisdom, your guidance, your courage, and your strength. Be with us in our deliberations and help us to be wise in the decisions that we make for the good of all those who have placed their trust and their confidence in our leadership. Give us the insight to lead with integrity, that our decisions may reflect what is right, and most importantly, what is good. Keep us from short-sightedness and pettiness. Help us to make those decisions that are for the good of all, and guard us from blind self-interest. All glory be to you, loving God. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Trustee Martinez, can I have you do the pledge?
Would you please repeat after me? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Ms. Vela.
Can I call Trustee Ms. Ramos for roll call, please? Ms. Ramos? We can't hear you. You're muted.
No, she's not.
No? We can't hear her.
Technical difficulties.
There he comes.
Okay, there it is.
Did I do something wrong?
I've unmuted on my side.
There you go.
Okay, we can hear you now.
Can you hear me now? Okay.
Yes.
Roll call for today, April the 8th. Lupita Cepeda.
Present.
Jorge J.D. Delgado.
Present.
Jackie Levin Ramos, present. Cynthia Mares. Mercurio Martinez Jr.
Present.
Henry Carranza. Esteban Rangel.
Present.
Karina Elizondo.
Present.
Tita Cantu Vela.
Ms. Vela.
Tita Cantu Vela.
Here.
Thank you. You have a quorum, ma'am.
Thank you. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present, that this meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act. Next item is approval of the minutes for regular Board of Trustees meeting of March 4th and special board meeting of trustees meeting of March the 10th, 2021.
I so move, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? I hear none. Motion passes. Thank you. I understand we have no public testimony. Thank you. The next item is recognition, communication, introduction of personnel and new personnel actions for the month. Dr. Solis.
Yes, Madam Chair, thank you. Yes, we have some recognitions on our marketing department. I'm gonna go ahead and jump and have Mr. Ober Guerrero and Michael Gonzalez give a quick summary of our recognitions.
Members of the board, Michael Gonzalez, Senior Director of External Affairs, for the record.
We have some wonderful news for you today, additional wonderful news on behalf of our very, very award-winning marketing group, Community and Media Relations Group. And now we've truly taken it to the next level by bringing home national level awards. So I'll allow, so I want to provide the director for the Community and Media Relations Office, Mr. Obed Guerrero, a couple of minutes to share the details.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
Obed Guerrero for the record, Community and Media Relations for Laredo College. Yeah, as Mr. Gonzalez was mentioning, it is with great honor and pride that we bring these awards to the Board of Trustees, to administration, to presidents of East, and everyone present. As Mr. Gonzalez mentioned, yeah, we're taking it to the next level, and never in the history of Laredo College, we have brought three awards home. This is a big accomplishment for the college, for our office, and it's going to be possible without the support of everyone here tonight. So I truly appreciate it. Just to give you a quick overview, what are the NCMPR Paragon Awards? They are prestigious Paragon Awards, recognize outstanding achievement in design and communication. For community and technical colleges. It is the only national competition of its kind that honors excellence exclusively among marketing and PR professionals at the year colleges. Colleges and universities from all over the United States, Puerto Rico, U.S. Virgin Islands, U.S. territories, and Canada participate in this prestigious annual marketing competition, and only the most creative marketing teams win these distinguished awards. So we were very lucky. The competition is fierce, because we're competing with colleges from all over the country and even Canada. So, you know, Texas is one of the most competitive states, yes. Also California, New York, Canada. You know, you have great colleges at Quebec, Canada, Vancouver, and you know, it's very, very hard to win this award. So I'm very, very proud to bring this to Laredo College.
So congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Madam Chair. Madam Chair, if I may.
Congratulations.
And with that, I'd like to recognize Dr. Henry Carranza has joined the board.
Okay. Madam Chair, I believe.
May I make some comments, Madam Chair?
Yes. I think
it is very, very important for this institution to acknowledge in the local newspaper and mentioned out, as already been singled out by, you know, by the manner in which you make these comments, that it not only includes the United States, but also includes other countries. And this is really an incredible achievement and incredible recognition for this type of award. And I think it is quite a recognition that in the history of this institution, we've never gotten.
Right.
Our community should be made aware by properly acknowledging it in our local newspaper. And if anything, perhaps maybe even a full page or something to that effect that let our community know that this type of achievement has been recognized throughout not only the United States, but also other countries that also includes Canada, correct?
That's correct, sir.
So yes. It's really quite a recognition, and I certainly congratulate you, and I know I speak in behalf of other members of this board. We're very proud of you and continued success, sir. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Before I recognize you, the chair wants to recognize Cynthia Mares has joined our meeting. I recognize Mr.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Gonzalez and Mr. Guerrero. It's really nice to see. I know that when we came in, myself, Ms. Cepeda and Mr. Delgado, you know, we looked at how strong LC was being marketed, and I'm very happy to see that. Now it was already at a very high peak, and now where you guys are at, you just have taken it to another level. So I congratulate you, and I'm happy to say that we're a part of your team now as well. So congratulations
Thank
and keep up
much.
The good work, guys.
Team
honestly.
Yes.
Great job.
Chair recognizes Ms. Mares. I think Ms. Mares wanted to say something.
Well,
now.
Where is she?
She's over there.
Oh.
Ms. Mares?
Right in front of you. Go ahead, Ms. Mares.
Ms. Mares, did you want to say something? I saw you raise your hand.
Yes, ma'am. I'll just say congratulations again, also, all around to everybody for all their hard work. Thank you.
Thank you. The chair recognizes Dr. Carranza.
No, let me just say this, that for the past 4 years, and we started kind of low, and the first thing that I said was what? We got to market, mm-hmm. and we got to do PR work. And this is your reward?
That's cool. Yes.
And the reward for the college.
Thank you for all your support.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Ms. Elizondo.
Hi, good afternoon. I just wanted to say congratulations of it. I know you
Thank
work
you.
Very, very, very hard and all your team, and congratulations.
Thank you, Ms. Elizondo. Appreciate it.
Un abrazo.
Igualmente.
Anyone else? Well, on behalf of myself and the board.
No, thank you. Thank you very much.
We're very proud of what you all are doing, you and your staff. We appreciate all the awards that you continue mm-hmm. bringing to our college. I mean, it's just, we've done it statewide, we've done it national and Canada. So
yes.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate it.
Thank you for all your support.
Thank you.
And ma'am, if I could, I would just
yes.
want to say very much on behalf of everybody, the whole team, it is very much a team effort, and it starts with your support and you supporting this team and allowing us to bring these kinds of awards home. But it's also the rest of our team, because we communicate the message, but they make the news. They make the news, and then we go out and communicate it to everybody else. So it truly is a team win. Thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you, board members.
Thank you.
Is that all for recognitions, communications, Dr. Solis?
I believe, yes, we have that. I have other communications. But I just
Thank
want
you.
To add, yes, just like it was mentioned, these recognitions are due to the incredible work that all the instructors and the staff have achieved, and primarily with the rankings that we had obtained last year. And more importantly, just like as you know, anywhere you go, not only in Laredo but in Texas, the first thing I hear when the name Laredo College is mentioned is, oh, you're the ones that have that really unique health and nursing program. And even this morning when I was in Austin, that was mentioned to me, that people know that when Laredo College is, actually when the name Laredo is mentioned, that's the first thing that comes out of people's mouth about our incredible health and nursing programs that we have here. And of course, the message has been put out appropriately, but again, the hard work has been done by all the staff in the nursing and of course our students. Thank you. Moving on, we have all communications. I'm going to have Dr. Diana Miller, speaking of our health and nursing programs. She has a few words. As you know, we had some unfortunate news a few days ago, the passing of one of our esteemed faculty members. Ms. Miller.
For the record, my name is Dr. Diana Miller, Dean of Health Sciences. Thank you, Board of Trustees, members. And I could make it through this, okay? President and administration, for this opportunity. I am present today to honor Mr. Arturo Navarro. He started his journey in nursing as a nurse assistant, and where he worked at Laredo Medical Center, and started in 1982 as a nurse assistant. He continued and came back to our program. He's a product of our program, vocational nursing program. He graduated in 1994, and he worked for 37 years at LMC and 25 years for us as an instructor in the nurse assistant program. He worked in emergency room, oncology unit, and the medical surgical healthcare. With that, his goal was always to promote students and their healthcare to continue to learn, not to stop just at the nurse assistant level, but to use it as a stepping stone so that others can continue to grow and to develop. With him, he was our first program to do dual enrollment. And many of you probably didn't realize that. It started at LBJ, our nurse assistant program, when we were the first. That was in 2007. In 2013, he was an innovator as well and went to Zapata and started a nurse assistant program there. With that, these groups had 100% certification during his tenure there. Along with that, Dr. Fred Solis and I had gone to LBJ with him to evaluate it when we were getting ready for SACS. And he was so proud of those students. He talked about how much they wanted to learn, how well they competed with each other and worked together. So with that, I'm usually not this emotional, but it worked together 25 years. And he was not only someone I worked with, he was my friend. And he will definitely be missed during this time. But I know his legacy will go on with the students' lives he's touched in order to see them as they grow and develop in our programs. Thank you for sharing us honoring him tonight. Thank you very much.
No, thank you.
Our sincere condolences to you and all the students that were able to be in his classes. He sounded like he was an excellent employee of ours in LMC. So I wouldn't have been able to say it all. I think I would have started crying. But our sincere condolences on behalf of the Board of Directors. Chair recognizes Mr. Martinez.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Would it be possible for this board, and including our administration, to come up with a proper resolution that acknowledges all of the different accomplishments that already have been mentioned by Dr. Miller, and not only come up with that resolution, but if at all possible, frame it, and then have that given to the family. Because that is the least that this college, you know, should give, particularly more so in the manner in which he has devoted his life to what the achievement that Laredo and the nursing program has distinguished itself, and certainly he was obviously one of those members within that group.
Wonderful suggestion.
And I would like to, if it's all right with members of this board, to, with the help of legal counsel, to come up with a proper manner in which a resolution is properly acknowledged and then properly framed, so that the family would be given that recognition.
And a proper presentation as well at one of our board meetings. Are you doing a proposal or?
I would like to make that into a motion if it's all right with you, Madam Chair.
Yes, sir. Rusty?
I definitely think that the board, with the instruction given, can advise administration and counsel to proceed in that way. However, I would not suggest a motion at this meeting.
Okay.
And I think if it's set for whatever meeting, the board president and college president, when next meeting, for example,
to bring it.
Yeah, you prepare the motions, execute the resolution, present it to the family, things like that.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Martinez. Anyone else? Chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
Madam Chair, I'd like to request a moment of silence for Mr. Navarro and a short prayer to honor him. I know that we give our deepest condolences to the family, but also he was a part of our staff and he was a family member. So at this time, may I ask for a moment of silence in honor of Mr. Navarro?
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
Thank you. Chair recognizes Dr.
Well, you know, it is difficult, you know, when I heard that doctor speaking, because working in the hospital itself for about 30 years, I think, recognition is never really given to us. Yeah. Recognition is never really given to us, you know, we just do our job. But I'm so glad that this young man is being recognized for his work,
his diligence, and his dedication to the college and to the program. Thank you, Dean.
Anyone else? Dr. Solis?
Thank you. Yes, now we're going on to another activity that has really kept us busy. It's donations. And this is what a new area that we have been growing. I'm going to have Michael Gonzalez to give the two significant donations that we continue obtaining.
Thank you, Dr. Solis, members of the board. Michael Gonzalez, Senior Director of External Affairs, for the record. I do have some great news to share with you today regarding some recent philanthropy to the college. Some of you may have seen some of this philanthropy firsthand by being present at some check presentations. The first I'd like to share with you was from the Laredo International Fair and Exposition. There was a scholarship fund started in the name of Mr. Jerome Jordan. And it's the Jerome Jordan Rancher of the Year Scholarship Fund. This was made possible through Texas Community Bank and the Life Board, and of course, Mr. Jordan, that made all of this possible. And this is going to help students with scholarships who have participated in life regardless of their major. As all of you know, life is a critical part of our community, teaches a lot of fantastic values, and we're proud to partner not only with this board, but to commemorate the Rancher of the Year Award for Mr. Jordan. We think it's a fantastic program. And as you can see pictured, there were members of the Life Board here present, as well as their executive director and many others that were here to help and to commemorate the beginning of this scholarship fund. The total amount was $22,000 that will start this scholarship fund. And so this will go a long way to help a number of students here at the college.
Wonderful.
The second piece of information I'd like to share with you is the latest in annual donations that we receive for the activities of the Economic Development Center and scholarships in that regard from the Laredo Licensed U.S. Customs Brokers Association, or LUSBA. This particular donation was $3,000, and you can see here a recent check presentation here in the boardroom with members of the LUSBA board, where they are providing this great donation to the Economic Development Center and to students who are taking courses through that. So just a couple of the most recent donations to the college that I'd like to share with you.
Thank you. Okay. That's wonderful news as far as for the college. Any chair recognizes Mr. Duncan?
Before we move on from number five, may I just mention, I want to congratulate all staff on I know we've been having a lot of vaccine drives, and you guys have been doing a remarkable job, and I mean everybody from Dr. Solis all the way to people setting up the tents. You know, we're putting ourselves out there to help the community on such hardship times. I want to tell everybody that what we've been doing, you know, and I'm talking about every government entity, because I know us over there at LISD, we've been doing drives as well. And it's about putting everybody's little part to help the community. So on behalf of myself, I do want to say thank you to the staff on doing a great job and helping the community, because it takes a lot of effort to do that. So congratulations on each and every one of you that has taken part in doing that for our community. Thank you.
Very true.
Thank you. Anyone else? Dr. Solis? Thank you, Mr. Gonzalez.
Yes, I'll move on quickly. On April 15th, we're going to be launching our annual employee recognition ceremony, and we'll be sending you a list of the participants and those that are obtaining that award. That's just an informational item. The next one, I'm going to have Ms. Dean Heriberto and Dean Sandra Cortez as well to please quickly give us another area that we are venturing in trainings. Where are they? Yeah, they are. These trainings are very unique to adding to our mission, continuing in other areas. So I'm trying to put you all on the spot there, but it's best that they hear from you. Exactly.
Good afternoon. Sandra Cortez, Dean of Community Education. What I wanted to advise the board this evening was an initiative that we're working with Border Patrol agents. We were approached by them to train bus drivers due to the need that they have right now because of the migration. They have a really huge need to train bus drivers. So I'm happy to say that really soon, hopefully in May, we will be training between 20 and 30 bus drivers that are currently agents, and we will offer that. We're offering them a 3-week program that they have accepted, and we're very thrilled to do this with Border Patrol, because this brings a new program to our college, because we will have now hired adjunct instructors to teach bus driving. Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you. And good evening, board members. Heriberto Hernandez, Dean of Workforce Education. Along those same lines, we're currently working on other partnerships and offering trainings to Border Patrol and Customs officers in the area of EMT. That's also a very much needed training for them, especially with what's going on right now. So with the help of the EMS director and Dr. Miller and her team, we were able to propose a proposal to them. It looks like it's going to be approved by the superiors at DHS, and that would open a whole bunch of other opportunities in the area of EMTs, and it will solidify Laredo as a hub for this type of EMT training, right? For not only the agents in Laredo, but the surrounding areas as well.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Excellent.
Great news.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions from the board? Thank you for that report. Dr. Solis?
Yes. Now for employees, we have several. Actually, we have two promotions very quickly. We have the e-learning instructional design specialist, Guadalupe Castillo, and also e-learning instructional design specialist, Veronica Juarez. And two new positions that we have filled is our financial aid technician, two, Juan Garcia, and our newest position that we have created due to the changes in technology and cybersecurity, we now have an information security officer, Mr. Orlando Gomez. I believe he's here virtually, as he should be, because that is his specialty. And so he's everywhere. And we're very fortunate. He came from McAllen, I understand, with many years' experience. But this position is going to be securing. It's a new requirement by the state, securing all of our information. So we're very fortunate to have him, and very happy.
Thank you, Dr. Solis, and welcome.
And also very quickly, as you probably noticed, a few days ago we sent out a notice of new hirees, but those were adjuncts, just to clarify. Primarily in the music and another area in the arts area, that those are all part-time as needed basis, so they're not necessarily hired, but we go through the process and we have them as if classes open up and needed in the fall and so on. So I just wanted to clarify that, because there was some questions about that. And with that said, I believe that's all I have right now for reports. Thank you.
Any questions on his report? Okay, so I'm going to move on to the next item. The faculty senate report. Mr. Masihani, I see him on.
Good evening, yeah. Everyone. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Linda. Okay. Oh, Linda. For the record, my name is Linda Ramirez, and I'm an assistant professor in the business department. I'm also the co-chair for the faculty senate elections committee. I'm going to give a very short presentation on our most recent elections before I hand it off to our faculty senate president. I will be sharing my screen. I hope there are no issues here. Oh, it is disabled. but we did want to give a short presentation.
Can you enable that, Ms. Bocanegra?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll just wait a second.
She's done so.
I got it. Okay. So, I hope everyone can see the screen.
Yes, we can.
We did host and did have our 2021 Faculty Senate elections just last month. This is a list of our previous officers. As you can see, we have a president, secretary, and we had three at-large positions up for election this year. You don't see our vice president there because the vice president position was not up for election this term. We go on even and odd terms. Our nominations consisted of one person for president, that was Prakash Mansinghani, one person for secretary, Ms. Leslie Spillane from Business SBS, Social and Behavioral Science, and we had five nominations for senator at large. You'll notice that four were from the main campus and one was from the South Campus. As per our constitution, you must have one South Campus representative. So if there's more than one person running, of course, the person with the most votes will get it. If not, the South Campus representative automatically gets a position as an at-large senator. So we had a really great turnout this year. We had a lot of people nominated. We actually had a couple of other people nominated for secretary, but a couple of them declined. For example, Maritza Morris declined the secretary nomination to run for at-large. So we did have a lot of people nominating, which was really great. Voting was available electronically via the Human Resource Survey. Electronic voting was available for 3 days. And of course, we voted electronically because of the pandemic to keep everyone safe and to try to increase voting. Our final results were as followed. For president, Prakash Mansinghani retained his seat. Secretary, we elected a new secretary, and that would be Ms. Leslie Spillane. And of the at-large senators, remember we had five people running, but only three positions were available. So with 66% of the vote, Dr. Joseph Crabtree with 68% of the vote, Ms. Maritza Morris, and as the South Campus representative, Mr. Armando Moreno was automatically given the South Campus Senator at Large position. Ballots were counted electronically on Friday, April 26th at a special faculty assembly meeting. Results were read aloud. Results for the election were ratified at the regular faculty assembly meeting on April 6th. Voter turnout was over 55%. So we did have a robust voter turnout. We're very happy about that. And the new faculty senate officers have already taken their positions and are currently serving. That is all that I have. I will give the rest of our time to our faculty senate president, Mr. Mansinghani. Are there any questions?
Just one question. It said Friday, April 26th. Was that March 26th where the votes were counted?
Yes. That is correct. That was my mistake.
Okay. Yes, March 26th.
Thank you.
Our apologies.
Any questions from the board?
No.
No. Okay, it's all yours, Mr. Mansinghani.
Thank you very much. You guys have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Well, it looks like you're stuck with me again. For the record, my name is, as you all know, Mr. Prakash Mansinghani, President of the Faculty Assembly and Associate Professor of Government. Good evening, members of the Board of Trustees, President of the Board, Ms. Cepeda, President of the College, Dr. Solis. Good evening, everyone. To begin today, and I'll make this brief since we already provided a presentation, on behalf of the faculty, I do want to take a quick moment on behalf of the faculty and to offer our sincere condolences to the Navarro family. His contributions to this college will forever enhance our community and, of course, its health. And having worked closely with his family, I want to send those personal condolences as well. On another note, I'd like to take a moment to congratulate the new executive team of the Faculty Assembly and the newly elected senators that you saw on the previous slide. I do want to make a note that if you noticed in the previous presentation, we did have a record turnout, and we did have candidates running for senator in departments that that we haven't seen in a long time. In other words, we're seeing participation from across the board, and this I think ushers in a new era for the Faculty Senate, especially for board members who've served for many years and know, of course, how times have changed with the Faculty Senate. And so I'm really excited about this new team. This represents a new vision, a new direction, and I'm incredibly excited about this. For the record, the Faculty Senate is now led by the following individuals. So I just want you to be aware of who the executive team is. It's myself as president, continuing for an additional 2 years. Our vice president, who's attending virtually today, is Ms. Victoria Rodriguez from the English department. And our newest secretary, who is a tenured professor and has been with the college for several years, is Ms. Leticia Spillane. So we are incredibly happy to have this new team. And this team, speaking on behalf of it, is looking forward to working with the board, its new leadership, the administration, to of course further the mission of the college, and namely to deliver student success and of course excellence. And this next part I cannot say enough, and I've said it to every board member and member of the administration personally, but I want to show a very great show of gratitude for the Board of Trustees, or to the Board of Trustees and to the administration, for recently approving the salary increase for all employees at Laredo College. We all know how terribly difficult this last year has been for all of us, personally and socially. No less at the college, obviously, this has been difficult. And so this action taken by the board and the administration, I know, is gonna go a long way to help people in their day-to-day lives. And so I cannot and will not stop thanking the board for taking those actions. I'm going to go a step further here and just say I've been receiving calls from all over the state and even from different parts of the country talking about how did the LC board and the LC administration manage to do that during a pandemic. And that's because we have great board members and great administrators who care about their employees when the tough gets going. And so thank you from the bottom of my heart. And finally, I'd like to thank the administration, namely the president of our college, Dr. Ricardo Solis, our vice president, Dr. Rodriguez Tijerina, and Dr. Fred Solis, and of course our faculty and staff, for working closely with me and allowing me to be part of the decision process here at the college, especially to help us all deliver on the promise of a better tomorrow for all of our community. So again, thank you for this opportunity. Good evening to everyone again.
Thank you. I'd like to recognize Karina Elizondo. You're muted.
I just wanted to congratulate all the faculty members that got elected. You all continue to do a great job, and congratulations again to Cash. We're glad and we're looking forward to working with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Congratulations, Trustee Elizondo said, congratulations to all. We're looking forward to working with the Senate staff. Congratulations, Cash. We get to continue working with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Next, I have the Associated Student Organization report.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Jesus Galaviz. First of all, I want to say good evening to board members, President Dr. Solis, Laredo College Administration, faculty, and staff. I have a few updates for you today. First being that ASO has been doing a lot of community service lately. We've been helping out the community as much as we can. We got involved with District 8 Council Member Alicia Cigarroa through her I Love Laredo campaign. We cleaned up a couple communities. We also have been working very closely with the New Vision Community Church and helping them make care packages for elderly. The beauty with New Vision Community Church is that they have partnered up with the training station and provided our students with much needed assistance with food and with supplies. So that's an awesome partnership that we have established with the training station, as well as we've been helping out with the COVID-19 vaccine drive that is happening at South Campus. We've been assessing the Office of Student Life any way we can. I also want to mention that ASO did make a donation to the trading station in the value of $1,000. We bought toiletries. They have now been made into care packages that students are now able to pick up and take if they need. As well as we hosted a workshop for students. Basically, the topic of the workshop was how to get the job with such a competitive job market. We thought it was really important to bring in one of the guest speakers that he's very popular here in Laredo College. His name is Obi Vasquez. And he brought a couple of his friends that gave students a real good insight on tips and skills how to get these high paying jobs that are in demand. That basically concludes my updates. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Galaviz, and thank you, the ASO, for doing such a great work for all the your fellow students here at the college. Any questions?
Thank you.
No, Madam Chair.
Okay. Yes,
yeah, Dr. Solis. Just a comment, thank you. I just wanted to point out that what an incredible, remarkable job the Associated Student Organization has done despite the challenges, you know, being thrown into this pandemic situation. Mr. Galaviz and all the other, his fellow students that participated in the events throughout the year were incredible, especially with the vaccine assistance and all the other activities that we had in helping out the community. We were extremely impressed about not only their disposition, their enthusiasm throughout this whole situation. And we're very proud that you kept your head up, Mr. Galaviz, and you had all of your fellow students do the same. And we are very proud of what you have done for the college. And we will be in debt for you to keep up this incredible positive attitude throughout this incredible pandemic. So thank you very much,
yes,
Mr.
Sir,
Galaviz.
Yes, sir, of course.
And we look forward
thank
to
thank you, continue. Mr. President.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes. Anyone else? The chair recognizes Mrs. Ramos.
I also want to commend the ASO and Dean Peña, Raquel Peña, and Mr. Carmelino Castillo for providing the leadership for the group. I spoke to Pastor Lucy de Leon, and she is very happy and excited that they were able to volunteer there with the New Vision Community Church. And so I'm very proud of them for taking the initiative to spearhead a collaborative effort with this community church that is bringing a lot of great benefits to our training station. So once again, I thank Mr. Galaviz, and also under the leadership of Ms. Peña and Mr. Carmelino Castillo, and the entire student life department. Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you. I'm gonna go ahead and move forward to the item 8A.
Madam Chair.
I recognize Ms. Ramos.
Madam Chair, I would like to make a motion to move item 10B before the consent agenda, as we have guests that are in the audience right now at the moment. And so I would like for 10B information on United Independent School District Early College Academy to be presented at this time. That is my motion.
I second.
I have a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Motion passes. So we move up item 10B, information on United Independent School District Early College Academy. Dr. Fred Solis, Mr. David H. Gonzalez, Ms. Angelica Sanchez, and Ms. Yesenia Sandoval.
Good evening, Madam Chair, ladies and gentlemen of the board. Fred Solis, Vice President for Student Success and Enrollment. This evening, you're going to be receiving information regarding a new initiative that LC and the United Independent School District will be embarking in the fall of 2021, this coming fall semester. And so to present to make that presentation, we have Lesenia Sandoval, who is the Dean of the Early College at Lyndon Baines Johnson High School. Thank you.
Okay, good evening, members of the board. My name is Yesenia Sandoval, and I'm the Dean for the Early College at United Independent School District at LBJ and the Blissia program. And this evening, I'm here to share some information on, actually, this is our sixth year. We've had two graduating classes for the Early College, and I'm trying to start share from the beginning. I knew it was that easy, but I didn't know how. Okay, at LBJ, this is our sixth year for the early college, our fourth year for the Blissia. This is our first graduating class, so this year we have two sets of graduates. We have a set of Associate of Art graduates and Associate of Science graduates. Okay, if you see on the enrollment from the first year, we had our very first cohort, which was class of 2019. Those were the pioneers of UISD, and we had 126 students in that class. Last year, we had 133. This year, which is class of 2021, we have two different groups. We have the first cohort for the Blissia, where we have 86 students, 138 seniors this year. And if you can, you can see on the other columns, those are the upcoming groups, our sophomores and junior sophomores and freshmen. We always start off with 100 Blissia students and 150 early college students. And then it kind of dwindles down depending on students moving. And it is, as you all know, it's college courses are not easy, and some students don't make it through. We do have how many associate graduates we had in the last 2 years. The first class, we had 93 students graduated with an associate's degree. And last year, we had 87. Those that didn't get, like from the 138, only 93 got the associates, but 28 of those still had 42 hours or more. Because sometimes that biology senior class is what gets them. So they're already halfway, more than halfway through, but they don't get to finish, okay? So we do have 27 that got the 42 hours or more last year, and 28 the first year. And then here we have a breakdown of how many hours each student gets per year. When you're a freshman, when you're in the early college, you can get up to 10 hours. As a freshman on the Blissia, you can get up to 9. And so forth. 10th grade, you get 12. Under the Blissia program, it's 15 hours. Under the early college, you get 15 hours your junior year. The Blissia, the junior year, is the hardest year. That's when they have 20 hours. And early college, their senior year, they have 23 hours. And under the Blissia program, they have 19. Both programs offer the 60 hours, Associate of Arts or Associate of Science, depending on the program they're in at the end of 4 years within their high school diploma. This year and the continuing years, what are our expected, or what we call the on-track kids? We do have this year 96 students on track out of 138 for the early college, and under the Blissia, we have 73 out of 86. So this year, God willing, in May, we should have, or whenever we have our graduation, we still don't write May, June, we should have 169 students get an associate's degree from Laredo College before they get their high school diploma from UISD. And I think all of this is a collaboration. Everybody's been talking about teamwork from the departments, but now I think this is teamwork within the district and the college, where we have provided all these opportunities for students. And we are located at LBJ, which is our southmost school for United Independent School District, but we do have Alexander United and United South students. And so it is a United ISD effort. There are students from all over the city that are getting these benefits and these opportunities to participate in this program. The following years, we do have the numbers there, 84, 57, that these juniors are the ones that have had the toughest year and a half, because when the pandemic started, of course, some kids kept going without any hiccups. Some of the other ones didn't, because mostly our students are at-risk students. We've had to give out a lot of MIFIs. We had to give out a lot of stuff because they don't have the stuff they need. But UISD made sure we provided everything they needed. And if they don't, and they still, we have students go to our campus. So that kind of shows there in the data where our numbers dropped. And not the enrollment, it's the numbers, the kids that are on track, because they do have a little bit, we have to provide more resources to those students. And finally, speaking of expanding, our district has, after we did the guinea pig with us, now we survived, so now we're going to United South. United South is now having an early college academy as well. There's an early college academy. There's different names, right? But it's, they're starting it also this fall with 100 students. So the application is already online, and they've already had all the PR stuff. And so students are applying and should be getting chosen, as just like we do ours, the blind performance lottery. And hopefully the district will be able to expand through all four high schools, where all students across the district will have the same opportunity as our LBJ kids have had for the last 6 years. And that's it. Any questions?
May I?
Yes, Madam Chair. Chair recognizes Mr. Martinez.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. And without putting you on the spot, I know that there seems to be quite a bit of discussion. What is your feeling in reference to the early college program versus the regular academic program, where students will not go through the early college, but they will go through the graduate regularly high school and then start their first year in college? What is your feeling? Is there right now more initiative, more aggressiveness in encouraging these students to go through the early college? I sure would like for you, what do you feel about the future of this?
Okay, in my opinion, because I'm an educator, and in my family, as we always push, we always try to say, okay, well, go to college as soon as you can. But I think it all depends on the parents and the students, because not all students are ready to go to college at 14. Some of them are not even ready when they're 18. So it really depends on the student and the grit that each student has, because I've had 14-year-olds do phenomenal jobs and do things that an 18, 19-year-old wouldn't have been able to do. I think it all depends, Mr. Martinez, on the student itself and the parent. But I myself, as an educator, would say you're saving yourself 2 years, you're getting a 2-year start, you're a handicap, what, in golf or whatever, and like you're ahead of everybody else. But that's up to you. And the students will ask me, what do I need to do? I said, you don't even, because we don't check GPAs or any of that stuff. It's performance blind lottery, you're chosen. You are given all the academic support, emotional and social support. All you have to do is bring your ganas, like I tell them,
so,
and be here every day.
On your opinion, you feel that there's a greater future for these students than for the regular students that go through high school?
Yes, for those that are ready.
Yes.
Because if you're not ready, Mr. Martinez, their GPA is affected. I tell them, this is like your credit score. Like,
yes.
When you go off, that's going to affect you. It's going to haunt you. So you need to be ready to work on that from day one.
Which is for those students that have gone through the early college and for the families, there's a considerable amount of savings.
Yes.
Otherwise, they would have to go through that additional expense.
Yes, Mr. Martinez. I actually always say this at my meetings. I said, congratulations. It's like you've won a $20,000 lottery, because that's what about an associate costs, about $20,000 depending where you go. Because it is a big savings, especially more than anything, the savings to our economically disadvantaged parents, but the time, and I think that their child fell, because maybe their child wouldn't have gone, even if they were already 18, they could have gone financial aid, but you have to go and look. We provide everything for them. We make it easier for them. We're that safety net, and tell them it's okay, we're gonna help you. And so when they leave us, they've already have 2 years of college. So they're a step ahead. They maybe that confidence that I can do it. I was already able to do it. So yes, it is a game changer for a lot of economically disadvantaged parents.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Ms. Sandoval, I just wanted to thank you, you and your staff and everybody with the early college program, and thank you to employee for all the hard work that y'all do. As you had mentioned, it's definitely not easy for a lot of the students who may not be ready, but I think with your enthusiasm that you show in this presentation and the encouragement that you give these students, it's definitely heartwarming, and I say for myself that's here, and encouraging as far as with the way the future stands, as far as with those students in that program, especially since they're now expanding to United South. It's definitely great to hear, so thank you for everything that you do.
Thank you, thank you. And I am kind of hard on the kids. I'm like, no, I don't put them any slack.
Not a bad thing.
I'd like to recognize Dr. Carranza.
One thing that I look at, and it went back many years when high school used to graduate at 15 and 16. And the major problem that they were running into in college was that the age limit and the mental status. So are you preparing them to face the real world? You know, yes, 20 grand is 20 grand. I understand that. It's nice to say it. But can these students, when they go into the real college as juniors, that's a big lift. Because I remember when I was a junior, I remember seeing a genius when I was at St. Thomas. He was about 12 years old, and he was going to graduate with us. But he was a genius. He's already been accepted to a PhD program. So, you know, how are this, are the kids being prepared mentally when they go out?
Actually, we do. We have a summer bridge before this summer, when they start their freshman year. We have a summer bridge, and that bridge entails academic preparation for TSI, now the TSI 2A, TSI 8 2.0. But we also do the emotional aspects. We incorporate, one of them is GPA, LCs, Student Services Department talks to the kids and tells them about GPA. Then we have how to handle stress, relationships, things that they need to, because of their age, and they're already in high school and they have all of these other issues, we do try to incorporate all of the different mental, and now this year, we're actually partnering with UTRGV because they're doing a pilot at LBJ. So we're actually having all of these different mental, emotional, social topics covered with these students. Because even without the college, just the average high school kid, we've had an increase in students coming into the 504 programs for different anxiety and all these different other things that they've been diagnosed with. So it's not only the early college kids, it's the average child that is the ones that are not used. I mean, it's been hard for a lot of students.
Yeah, but those ones were big jumping up there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
There's a big difference when you talk about children down here, they're not there yet. They're going to graduate at a regular graduation.
Yes.
And they'll start as freshmen. So they'll be with a group, their group. Now, the ones that graduate from early college, they'll be way up here.
Yes.
And their mental status there in dealing with this type of older individuals. 2 years is a big difference.
Yes. Yes, we do incorporate different mental, I actually don't know, we just had this, we had our second group graduating this year, and actually one of our students, Kathy Chavez, is a graduate of 2019. She's doing some research at A&M College Station, and she's coming in to talk to our students about on that in the psychology and the sociology class, but she's already at A&M College Station doing like research for that. So that's one student. I don't have the data or haven't done a survey on that.
I understand all the data. I mean, you don't have to explain to me. But the thing is that, you know, a lot of young girls and young boys, they do get hurt up there, you know, when they get up there, and a lot of them don't complete because they burn out and they don't get to complete. Later on, they come back and finish.
Yes.
You know, that's when, because I think there was a study done on that. I don't remember what year, but it was studied early. And a lot of those young kids did have a hard time in college when they went to the real college.
Yes.
A real student, their age, and they look at themselves and look at themselves very young.
Well, I try to, right now when you said real students, I try to always tell this because I had one parent tell me the second year, she's like, the work that the teacher is giving is very hard. It's like real college.
Yeah,
and I said, no, ma'am, it is college. So the kids already know that the level of difficulty, the level of stuff, so they're kind of academically, we try to socially as well, and most of our students, I don't want to say all, but most of our students stay here at TAMIU, which is good because they're at home and they have that extra net. I do understand, like, if they go out of town and they're by themselves, if they're not emotionally prepared, that might be something that
The other thing is, do you work with the parents a little?
With
the
who?
With the parents.
Yes, a lot.
Because that's a nucleus right there, you know.
I think that's the game changer for our students because the parents are very involved. The parents are pushing those students.
Okay.
Which is good.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Dr. Solis?
A quick comment. Yes, I wanted to mention our relationship with United has been phenomenal, and we value this partnership, and we will continue working very diligently and innovatively in how we can be able to work for the benefit of our students throughout the entire community. And for that, we're very appreciative of your hard work and partnering with all of our different departments.
Thank you, and I appreciate your support as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Sandoval.
Thank you
for the presentation. Okay. Anything else on that? No?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you.
So I'm going to go to the 8A, approval of purchases of equipment through CARES Act funds. Approval for audiovisual equipment and installation purchases from Audiovisual Aids, San Antonio, Mr. Luciano Ramon.
I'd like to make a motion, Madam Chair, for the items 8A, for the approval of the audiovisual equipment installations, the approval of purchase equipment for transportation, the approval of the purchase of equipment for industrial technology, and the approval of purchase of equipment for Law Enforcement Academy, as well as 8B, approval of Oracle license and support renewal, as well as the acknowledgement of the financial report that was done by Mr. Vela. I'd like to make a motion that we acknowledge this consent item.
Okay, so Mr. Martinez, do I have a second?
Second.
By Ms. Vela. Any discussion?
One comment that I would just like to make, if it's possible, I know it was discussed in the Finance Committee meeting, but with regards to anything that can be purchased locally, if that could be done so, Mr. Vela?
That's...
I believe there were some items that were on there with regards to vehicles that were able to be purchased rather than purchasing it from out of town, if we can do it locally here and deal with the local vendors here.
Yeah, very good idea.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board. For the record, Cesar Vela, VP of Finance. Yes, Mr. Delgado, as soon as we receive approval, we're going to start the procurement process, and we'll start contacting our local vendors to see if we can get a good pricing on these items. Okay.
Perfect. Thank you, Mr. Vela.
Thank you.
Okay.
Any other discussion?
No.
No? Okay. So all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Discussion and possible action. Approval of the 2021-2022 Laredo College Academic Calendar. Dr. Fred Solis.
Good evening. Fred Solis, Vice President for Student Success and Enrollment. Madam Chair, ladies and gentlemen of the board, before you is the academic calendar for the upcoming school year. Every year we present the academic calendar to set up our start and end dates per semester, and in coordination with our local partnering institutions such as TAMIU in both school districts. And so it outlines all the different dates of instruction. It outlines all the dates of holidays as well. Same number of holidays, same number of days of instruction are in this calendar. The only major difference is that the fall semester is going to be starting a week later than we would typically be starting. And that's purposely done because it helps us align with the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board official calendar, which says you can start as late as August the 23rd, and we have discovered that that's a better choice for us because by having the school district start a week earlier, they're able to settle their registrations before they come and settle their registration with us, especially for the dual credit students. So our recommendation is that the board approve the calendar as presented.
Thank you. Do I have a motion?
Mr.
Rangel, a second? Mrs. Vela, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Aye. Any opposed? No. Motion carries.
Thank you, Dr. Solis.
I'm sorry?
No.
Thank you, Dr. Solis. Ratification of HVAC repairs for the Cigarroa Science Complex. Mr. Cesar Vela.
Yes, Madam Chair. This next item, we are asking that the board ratify the contract in the amount of $194,700 with Train for HVAC equipment repairs at the Cigarroa Science Complex. Procurement for this contract was made under buy board contract number 631-20. The repairs needed are a result of equipment damages caused by excessively low temperatures and loss of power during the February winter storm. Damages included ruptured coils, damages to the variable frequency drives, unit controllers, duct insulation, and ceiling tiles. The purchase order was submitted as an emergency item in order to expedite the delivery of equipment. Funding for this purchase is being made through insurance reimbursement. Our insurance carrier has already approved the replacement of this equipment. In addition to that, they have also approved costs for water mitigation, testing of air quality control, air quality testing, painting. Total cost are approximately $225,000 for this particular damages. We are still currently working on some additional cost to replace some audiovisual equipment that was damaged by water. Again, our insurance carrier is ready to proceed with payment, pending only those audiovisual items. In addition, our risk management office is currently working with the Texas Division of Emergency Management on obtaining information to submit a claim under FEMA for the expenses that are not covered by insurance carrier. Those are approximately $25,000, which is our deductible at this time.
Okay. Okay. So moved, Madam Chair, that we approve this.
Second. So I have a motion by Ms. Mares. I have a second by Mr. Delgado. Any discussion?
Second.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Next item, 9C, is approval of contract for facilities master plan phase 3, roof improvements and soffit and LED lightning upgrades project. Mr. Cesar Vela?
Yes, Madam Chair, members of the board, this next item is requesting that the board approve a contract with American Contracting and Roofing in the amount of $3,863,800 for South Campus roofing improvements, soffit and lighting upgrades, and for roof improvements at the Fort McIntosh Bookstore building. The project bid is under TCPN contract number TX R180903-309753. We're also asking for approval to use $226,000 from the bookstore fund balance to cover costs for the roof improvements at the Fort McIntosh bookstore building. Currently, the bookstore fund balance has $1.9 million. The work that will be done includes roof restorations for 6 buildings at the South Campus and 1 here at the Fort McIntosh Campus. Also, the installation of metal soffit along all the covered walkways and entrances at the South Campus and included with the associated LED lighting in those areas. Also, the work includes painting all the walkway and staircase hand railings at the South Campus. The contract includes a 20-year warranty on Tremco roofing products and a two-year installer warranty from the date of completion. It also includes field inspections on years 2, 5, 10, and 15. The work should be completed in approximately 12 months. Again, funding for this project comes from $3.6 million from the bond proceeds and $226,000 from the bookstore fund balance for a total cost of $3,863,800.
Motion to approve, Madam Chair.
I have a motion by Ms. Mares, a second by Ms. Vela. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Next item is termination of 9-month faculty position and reassignment of tenured faculty member pursuant to Laredo College Board policies. DMB local, termination of employment, tenure, and DMC local, termination of employment, reduction in force.
Yes.
Dr. Solis.
Yes, ma'am. This is a legal procedure that when a faculty is being reassigned, we have to have the board approve this. It's a faculty member that is aware in an agreement to be moved to another area. So if there's any questions, I'll have Dr. Maricel elaborate if that's necessary or any questions on that matter.
Do any board members have any questions?
No. I don't see anything.
Do I have a motion?
Second.
Have a motion by Mr. Rangel, a second by Mr. Delgado. Any discussion?
Second.
Board here none.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next item 9E, discussion of possible approval of a temporary lease agreement between Laredo College and About Time Incorporated. Dr. Ricardo Solis?
Yes, ma'am. This is a very unique opportunity for us to continue expanding, to having more donors and participants in our college. The company About Time is, they're the owners of the Laredo Heat. And thank to the trustee, Jorge Delgado, has brought this opportunity to us. Basically, they're interested in partnering with the college and wanting to temporarily lease our soccer field in the South Campus. Mr. J.D. Delgado, I'd be happy you elaborate a little bit more on this.
Yeah, the conversations that took place, I think, with that was we were approached with regards to About Time or the Vaswani family, as we know, a very philanthropic family that does a lot for not only the city of Laredo, and I think it's a great opportunity for us to be a part, or the Vaswanis to be a part of the LC family with regards with their generosity, and also, you know, taking part with regards to the Laredo Heat, which is the youth group, Laredo Heat Youth, right, if I'm not mistaken, that takes part in regards to the city of Laredo. And we're very gracious and very grateful for them reaching out, not only to myself, but also to Dr. Solis, with regards to their generosity. So.
I don't know if there's any questions.
No questions.
No,
not at all. So move.
Do I have a motion? I have a motion by Dr. Carranza. I have a second?
Second.
By Mr. Martinez. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 9F, rescind resolution of the Board of Trustees of Laredo College, COVID-19 virus. And this is, I looked at you, and this is the resolution that we had initially when we started with the COVID virus, that we had given all powers, I guess, to make decisions, emergency decisions, to Dr. Ricardo Solis. As we see it, pretty much everything is coming back to normal slowly, so we as some of the board members decided to go ahead and bring this, to rescind the resolution from Dr. Solis and go back to the way it used to be.
Madam Chair, ma'am.
Any questions?
No questions.
I just
Mr.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to definitely say, you know, very grateful for the hard work that not only Dr. Solis, but also the entire admin team, faculty, staff, including some of the students that were led by your leadership during this time. You know, we're very grateful, especially in the beginning, for the numbers that came out, that, you know, through your direction, that everybody was kept safe, especially the students and the faculty and staff. And for that, we're very grateful for your leadership throughout that time. So thank you.
Anyone else?
No. Don't move.
No? Okay. Do I have a motion by Dr. Carranza?
Ms. Ramos has a question.
Oh, Ms. Ramos, I'm sorry.
Ramos.
Chair recognizes Ms. Ramos.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do want to echo the same sentiments that Mr. Delgado said, but I want to go a little bit step further. I do want to acknowledge all of the assistance and the help that everyone in our community of Laredo College did during the COVID. If it's not over, we realize that. But however, we became the trendsetters in the community because other entities decided to go ahead and provide that authority to their leaders as well. And so we commend the board for taking that action at the time. It was needed, it was done. And so I commend Dr. Solis for a job well done and continuing to do a job that is necessary to move us to the next level. And so I do want to acknowledge the individuals that have collaboratively worked together, making this work, because it is a difficult time and it's affecting many people. So. I do appreciate all of the hard work that everybody has done, and thank you so much for what you did during that time and what you do all the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Ramos. Anyone else? Okay, so the motion, I have the first motion from Dr. Carranza. Do I have a second?
So moved.
From Mr. Delgado. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Dr. Solis, and your staff. You all did an outstanding job during the pandemic, and we really appreciate it as board members. Thank you.
Thank you. We're grateful for your comments, and I want to again thank the staff For the board, also most importantly, having the trust in us that we were going to do the right thing during this incredible experience for all of us. And fortunately, we did not have to enact any special duties or responsibilities on behalf of the administration, but it was a great possibility to have an option in the event of an emergency. But of course, I want to thank the board again, not only for having the trust, but for being there with us throughout this daily with me, especially on inquiring, on offering assistance, and especially the board that even later helped throughout this in providing donations, food, that just went on and on, so many things that the staff and the board did for the entire Laredo employee community. So again, this was we're going to continue. Nothing has changed other than we're going to continue being more efficient, and now the board will have these responsibilities to enact on and act upon it. And so again, we're very content in our efficiency, and also want to add what Trustee Ramos just said. Yeah, we were the first one. We were the trailblazers that showed leadership, true leadership, in trust of working together. And then all the other institutions throughout the region followed our lead in providing this similar type of responsibilities to their top management. But again, we were grateful that the people of Laredo noted that the Laredo College immediately took action in many areas and throughout the state. And again, this is thanks for a very courageous and visionary board. For that, we're very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Solis.
Thank you, Dr. Solis.
So I'll move on to the information items. 10A, student activities and future programs. Dr. Ricardo Solis.
Yes, very quickly, I have Dr. Fred here and Dr. Maricel, if we need to elaborate. We have finally come to, harboring and trying to decide on the commencement graduation date, and we've all decided that it's best to bring everybody back in person. So we're going to have an historical occasion of having it in an open area. Dr. Fred, can you please elaborate of our commencement exercise?
Thank you, Dr. Solis. Fred Solis, Vice President for Student Success and Enrollment. We have explored different alternatives or options for our graduation that's coming up a month from now. And overwhelmingly, I think the consensus from the college community is that we proceed with a in-person graduation. Knowing very well the situation and the conditions that the COVID protocols require, we have turned to one of our dual credit partners, in this case, United Independent School District, who have graciously offered their student activity center, their football field, to be able then for us to host our graduation out in the open. And so we're currently in having our discussions with them so that we understand what their house rules are and how we want to use their facility for our ceremony as well. And so it gives me great pleasure to present that option to the board as an informational item that we're going to proceed with those discussions. Our intended graduation date is May the 7th with a rehearsal date of May the 6th. And so, but it'll be out in the open following all social distancing requirements and so forth.
Great job.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions on that?
No, ma'am.
Nope. Okay. Next item is 10C, Leadership Academy update. Mr. Carmelino Castillo.
Thank you.
Good evening, Madam President, Ms. Lupita Cepeda, board members, Dr. Ricardo Solis, administrators, and guests. My name is Carmelino Castillo, Director of Student Life, and it is my, for the record, it is my pleasure today to present to you information pertaining to our Student Leadership Academy. As you all are aware, in the past, engagement here at Laredo College has always been a face-to-face endeavor. But as we move forward with the COVID-19 pandemic that occurred last year and this year as well, we've decided to morph our academic or our student leadership academy program into a virtual environment. In this virtual environment, we want to take our students on a leadership roles where they encompass or incorporate their academic skills, and more importantly, they are provided information to pursue their career. With that said, we designed and created a five-day workshop of information for our students to go through. In that, on our first workshop or our first academy on October the 22nd, we invited our presenter, Mr. Valton Stinson, to come and present students on information on how to use social platforms effectively. In this session, we had a group of students that ranging from 100 to 200 in attendees that learned how to effectively use social platforms in their leadership roles. While we ventured into the month of November, we invited Mr. Emmanuel Kwambi on November the 12th to provide 5 key points on how to be successful during COVID-19. A lot of our students during this time were unable to communicate with their peers face-to-face, so Mr. Kwambi provided them keys, these 5 keys of academics, professionalism, experience, time, and discipline, where they became successful and were able to transition not only from one class to the next, but more importantly, from the fall to the spring. Which brings us now to the spring semester, where we have, on February the 25th, we invited a local leader, Commissioner Rosaura Wawi Tejerina, to present to our students on decision-making. Ms. Tejerina provided our students 6 key points, and where they were able to identify the problem, determine the roots of the cause of the problem, find multiple solutions to that problem, determine the optimal solution to the problem, implement a solution that they've decided, and more importantly, find the success of that solution. So our students who participated in these leadership academies came back with a great amount of knowledge. In addition to that, we also invited, on March the 25th, we invited a unique perspective on leadership by inviting an individual that participated as a ninja warrior, but also provides a lot of promotional growth. And so this individual provided the students how to identify their values, and more importantly, how to identify those values to create a strong and comprehensive mindset. A lot of our students, because of COVID, do not have that opportunity to communicate. So this, allowing them to self-become valued, really encouraged them to become more of an effective leader. And finally, our last presenter is Ms. Marta Hernandez. She's scheduled to present next Thursday at 2 p.m., and her presentation is going to entail as artificial intelligence and the role it impacts on leaders. As we're all aware, our phones currently contain some artificial intelligence. We have either, if you have an iPhone, it's Siri. If you have an Android phone, it's Bixby. If you have an Alexa at home or an Amazon Echo, you have Alexa. So with this guidance, students are being able to provide a better, well-rounded leadership program. Now, that is our leadership program. However, in the Office of Student Life, not only do we do leadership programming, but we also do speaker series. So in the past year, we've conducted virtual speaker series where we brought in Dr. Ferris Till, who not only did one presentation, but did 2 presentations in one day. The first presentation, Engaging, Managing Change in Turbulent Times, while the second one is Making Healthy Choices. This was conducted on October the 28th. And then we also brought in, and you've heard earlier by ASO President, Mr. Galaviz, in regards to Ovi Vasquez. The Associated Student Organization, or ASO, brought Ovi Vasquez here on campus to provide not only one presentation on how to be successful and how to combat the difficulties from coming from Guatemala to the US and becoming successful, but also to provide guidance on how to land that job virtually, because that is one key component that a lot of our students are missing in these virtual times. One thing that I can say that COVID allowed us to do is to become creative on how we engage our students. And finally, we're concluding on our next week, on April the 20th and April 27th, with Ms. Soledad Tanner. She's going to be providing 2 presentations. One presentation on regarding turning your passion into profit, and the second one is a workshop on growing your dreams. The workshop itself is going to help students manage their budget, learn how to use whatever finances to create their dream into a reality. So in front of you, I provided you all flyers pertaining to these events, the last three events, and I encourage you to visit the webpage that's on the bottom so you can register and participate on our events on that time. However, not only do we do leadership, but we also do speaker series. We have a little bit more. I want to talk about one particular virtual event that is extremely successful, and that is our Palomino Talk. Through Palomino Talk, we invite faculty, we invite departments, we have co-curricular activities where students are engaged with each of these departments, so that way they're abreast of all the information that the departments have to offer. In case in point, just today we concluded a recruitment outreach effort with computer technology, Mr. Robert Moore, and providing students information on the new associate degree program of networking technology. Great success. We average on our Palomino Talks about 30 participants or 30 students, and now we're doing outreach efforts with the community. I'm working closely with the Occupational Therapy Assistant Program to make a community service type of promotion for that particular program. And so these are types of activities, virtual activities, that we host for our students and for more so for our community. But there's still a little bit more options. We provide virtual activities. You know, if there's educational events, then there's also some engagement, some relaxation. So during the spring of last year, starting in April to the summer, we provided 40 virtual engagement events. Now, for the fall and the spring semester, we have also provided 66 virtual engagement events, all ranging from Welcome Week, getting to know your peers, to having a drive-in movie this past October and November, which we're also working forward to providing a drive-in movie this coming month. As you all know, Laredo, the city of Laredo, currently only has one movie theater, and I think this would be a great opportunity for Laredo College to provide that service for not only our students, but our community.
Thank you, Nino. Right.
Thank you. Is there any questions?
Any questions?
No. May I just say, wow. Like, it's interesting how we had to do a huge transition into doing everything virtual, and you guys, you did a very good job, Mr. Castillo. Congratulations to you and your team. Very good job.
Very innovative.
Yes,
thank you.
Hats off to you guys.
Yeah.
Good job. Thank you.
Good job.
Chair recognizes Dr. Solis.
Thank you, if you'll allow me. Yes, very well said. During these difficult times, it's hard to keep everyone's attention, especially with virtual technology and classes. I would like to point out very quickly, one of the speakers here is a personal friend, Soledad Tanner, that we were able to convince to, she's a renowned speaker, like a global speaker and author, and that has achieved numerous awards nationwide. And we're fortunate that we're focusing also on how to start a business, which is the goal of many students, especially our non-traditional students that come here with their dreams to start a business when we're going through our workforce programs. So just so for your information on the board, if you can participate, I highly recommend that this is not only for our students, but it's for everyone to learn about how people start a business and how they thrive. And that she's a unique person that has incredible financial acumen and brings ideas on how to start business, and then additionally how to motivate people as well to get started. Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you, Dr. Solis. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Castillo.
Yes.
Thank you.
That was phenomenal. That was really good information for keeping all the students involved.
Yes, thank you.
Even very going good. Through the pandemic, but that was very good. Thank you. We appreciate it.
Well, thank you.
Next item is a COVID-19 update. Dr. David Arezola.
Good evening, members of the board, Dr. Ricardo. My name is David Arezola, Vice President of Compliance and Risk Management, for the record. I want to provide a little update on what we've been up to as far as the health and safety of the institution. So in some of the topics that were we will cover today, one of the first actions that the board took after our move to shut down was to create the Health and Safety Operations Center. It's coming up on about a year anniversary since we've done that as an institution, right? So if you remember, that group is composed of about 17 people who were displaced from other units, from athletics, from the Camilo Prada Child Care Center. And when they first came on board, including myself, we were, I don't know how you better describe it than freaking out, right? We were freaking out with what we had to do. But it's been a lot of learning, and we've had to learn everything from how to contact trace to how to, identify symptoms and then how to keep the campus safe. And our latest endeavor has been to conduct the vaccine drives. Now, the team doesn't conduct them themselves. We coordinate and provide support. But we conducted our seventh drive this morning, a small drive, about 70 for employees only. And it was a walk-through drive-through. But over the last month and a half or so, we've vaccinated about 1,100 Laredoans, wow. More or less. And if you think about what that means, that's 2,200 injections because there were two doses up until last week. Today we started with the Johnson & Johnson. So the theme of the night seems to be the team, and it was truly a team effort. Our executive team, if you guys were out there, our executive team was actually running some of the registration tables, right? We had physical plant doing setup. We were working at the South Campus. We had campus police directing traffic. Mr. Castillo and his team directing traffic inside the gauntlet, as I would call it. And of course, our nursing and allied health actually administering the vaccines and serving in the post area. So it was a great overall. It really showed what we can do as an institution when we all really work together. And we've had a lot of compliments. I'm gonna just mention two that really stand out in my mind. One was from a nursing instructor who came up and congratulated our team for putting together a good drive. And her comments were along the lines, I said, it's one thing to hear it from us that everything's going well, but I'm getting a lot of compliments from outside the college about how the college is.
Awesome.
The other quote that I'll share, and a lot of these quotes were shared with us when in the post area, when people were sitting waiting for their 15 minutes to go up, they would talk to our staff. But one of them said, and it was an employee of the college that said, it's nice to see Laredo College do things better than everybody else, right? And that was the one that stood out, right? So one other number that I want to share with you. In the last 6 weeks on campus, we have had zero cases of the virus among students and staff. That ends my report. I'll take any questions.
Any questions?
Thank you, David.
Chair recognizes Mr. Duncan.
Yeah, just like what I said earlier, I was a part of the task force. That's what they called it at LISD. They just threw us into a room. Figure it out. You're in charge of this. You're in charge of that. So I completely understand what you went through, Dr. Arriazola. And again, I heard it through a lot of people as well of how well it was. Everything was being conducted within LC, and I think it starts with each and every one of you of having everything put in place, and then just driving and just putting the like it says, like when the rubber meets the road. Just putting it and just doing the best that you can. So again, like I said earlier, congratulations. I've heard it throughout the community of how successful you guys have been, and that just shows your all's hard work. So congratulations.
Thank you for the first.
Chair recognizes Mr. Delgado.
Mm-hmm. No, just wanted to echo the sentiments of Trustee Rangel, and definitely thanking you, Nari, for all of your efforts and also for your dedication to this. I think the only thing I just wanted to say, if that quote we can get with marketing and put that on a banner, shirt, whatever,
I will.
I like this system.
That's a good idea.
Chair recognizes Dr. Carranza.
Yes, The nursing department did great because I was there when they were given the COVID, when they were given the vaccine. And the students, they performed very well. Mm-hmm. And they did very well. And the instruction that they have received showed there on the spot. They acted like they've been in nursing for a long time. Mm-hmm. The people that were getting the injections, they just rolled up their arms and smile, and they got it, and they moved on. But you had to give credit to the instructors because the nursing department did very well, you know, and the nursing students were there. Not only the nursing students, but also the occupational students, the assistant students, all the programs that are in the medicine, the medical area, they were there and they did an excellent job.
Yes. So. Great job.
Any other?
Thank you.
Any other comments?
If you allow me very quickly. Yes.
Dr.
Yes,
Solis?
Yes, I'll try to be brief. I know it's been lengthy. I also would like to commend that now that we're talking about how quickly we move and how I want to just remind how back in spring break, very proud of what the entire administration did, that where we had robust scientific research. We met daily during that time so we could immediately mobilize and have and close down the college and go on to totally virtual. And this was thanks to everybody here. I know I really went into that sacrifice during that entire period of time. And we came out with a very unique and extremely effective strategy. And it worked out incredible. And unfortunately, other institutions, I'm not going to even mention which ones, but everywhere throughout, they were in denial of this whole pandemic. And they had to really deal with a lot of dysfunctional and other problems with the students and having to mobilize them later. For us, it was a very unique, easy transition because we planned ahead of time. And of course, the board was kept abreast of this on a daily basis. And again, we thank you for your trust, and that's what we did. So likewise, I want to point out, just like we closed down quickly, immediately a year ago, we're going to come back with a very aggressive promotion of how we're back now for business and how our students come back to where they want to be, which is in person. We're going to be doing that in the next few weeks to come back open assertively in the fall. In the summer, we're going to be, Dr. Maricela and Dr. Feb will give him more elaborations in our next month meeting of how we're going to roll out the classes. But we will continue with our safety features. However, we're very excited that just like we did if we closed down, we're going to open up very assertively and effectively in the fall.
Good job.
Thank you, Dr. Maricela. I have heard from Chief Hurd with the fire department. I've heard from Mr. Chamberlain, Mayor Pete Sines. What an excellent job our Laredo College employees and nursing program and everything has done for our community. Thank you. Really much appreciated.
Thank you.
Next item is the bond refunding update. Dr. Ricardo Solis and
yes,
Mr. Cesar Vela.
Thank you. Well, I'll try to be brief. We had a very intense meeting with the finance committee and went over the details of the bonds. And just in summary, and then of course if you have questions, Mr. Vela can answer those. We had $56 million that we refinanced basically and got refunded with a savings of $4.7 million of the life of the terms of those bonds. That's in essence what we did, and the Finance Committee, of course, went over that with us and consented to what we implemented. If you have any questions.
Before you, actually, I would like for you to single out what is the interest that is being paid on this refinancing a bond issue.
Yeah, but if I recall, unless you want to correct me, we went from a 5% to approximately a 2.1%. We really did the perfect timing, and I'm glad we were persistent, and more importantly, we were patient in working with our finance advisors. And then just the perfect timing, and it took us many meetings throughout the last 2 months. But again, the savings is 4.7 of the in the life of those bonds, the $56 million outstanding bonds that we have.
Great
Any
job.
Any questions?
Good job.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next item that we have is an update on voluntary separation plan. Mr. Cesar Vela.
Yes.
You don't get to go.
Madam Chair, members of the board, just a quick update on the voluntary separation plan. We had 18 applicants submit their agreements to participate in the voluntary separation plan. As of Tuesday of this week, we had five employees that withdrew their agreements. We currently have 6 faculty members, 4 administrative professional employees, and 3 classified employees, for a total of 13 employees moving forward with the voluntary separation plan. The total payout for these 13 employees is $525,758. The total cost for the salaries of these participants is $976,788. Replacement salaries for these positions would be $768,754, for potential annual savings of $208,034. We will have an update with the final numbers at the April 29th board meeting.
What's the deadline, sir? The deadline already passed for them.
The deadline for to submit the agreements, yes. There is a deadline to withdraw.
They did it before the 7th.
No, actually, the deadline to withdraw would be tomorrow at noon. Yes.
That was me. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Any questions?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Vela. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Vela, as always.
Thank you, Mr. Vela. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now we're going to go into executive session. A closed session discussion pursuant to Texas Government Code Sections 551.071 and 551.074 with Laredo College Attorney concerning updates on pending litigations filed against Laredo College. Do I have a motion?
So move.
So move.
So I have a motion by Mr. Delgado, a second by Dr. Carranza. Everybody in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed?
Nope.
Motion carries. So we go into executive session. So we came back from executive session. No action taken in executive session. No action needed in open session. So we're going to go to the next item, which would be discussion and possible action. No action was taken. Sorry about that. The next item is president's report. No report. So the next item we have is number 14. Next meeting date will be Thursday, April the 29th at 6 p.m. It'll be a regular Board of Trustees meeting. And do I have a motion to adjourn?
Madam Chair.
Second.
Yes. Just a minute.
Prior to closing for the adjournment,
I'd like to recognize Mr. Delgado.
Oh, thank you, Madam Chair. This being National Library Week, I wanted just to say thank you for the library staff. I'm not sure anybody's here on Zoom, but also most importantly, to our very own trustee, Ms. Jackie Ramos, during National Library Week. So thank you for all that you do, Ms. Jackie.
Thank you, all librarians. So I have a motion from Mr. Rangel. Do I have a second? Second from Ms. Vela. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, everybody. Motion passes. Meeting adjourned.
Thank you, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone.